I wasn't going to pass up the chance to come in and welcome Jim Symington this evening. Jim Symington has had a lifetime as a distinguished public servant, as well as an entertainer, appearing on Johnny Carson's Tonight Show and the Mike Douglas Show. He was born in a Wordsworthian sense trailing clouds of glory. His great-grandfather, John Hay, served as Lincoln's private secretary and then was Secretary of State under Presidents McKinley and Theodore Roosevelt. And his Republican grandfather, James Wadsworth, served in the Senate and in the House. And of course, his father, Senator Stuart Symington, was well known as a Democratic senator from Missouri. Now, we're going to have to figure out this evening whether we're going to say Missouri or Missouri. I read that one political speaker in Missouri had been charged as being politically ambidextrous oratorically ambidextrous, because depending upon who he was talking to, sometimes he would say Missouri, and other times he'd say Missouri. So you'll just have to take your pick. Senator Symington served four terms in the Senate. Jim Symington joined the Marine Corps at age 17 and served briefly in World War II. After graduating from Yale, he received his law degree from Columbia University. In his long career, he has served as an executive assistant to Attorney General Robert Kennedy, Deputy Director of President Kennedy's Food for Peace program. In 1966, President Lyndon Johnson appointed him Chief of Protocol. And in 1968, he was elected to Congress, where he served four terms in the House and chaired three congressional subcommittees. After he was defeated in his senatorial race, he returned to private practice of law. Actually, he went to a firm that he started with, his father had started, with Senator Smathers of Georgia. And it was at that time that he became very interested in America's relationship with Russia. He has received a certificate of merit signed by Russian President Vladimir Putin. Received it at the Russian embassy for his contribution to American culture and humanitarian work, and for fostering strong U.S.-Russian relations. Now, during all this time, Jim has had another occupation as a singer and a guitar player. During law school, he sang and played his guitar in the bar at the Sherry Netherland in New York. And during the 60s, he played one night at the Cellar Door in Georgetown. And he still often plays and sings at social events. But I don't think he's here this evening to sing. But maybe we can get him here for that for another evening and ask him to bring his guitar. Tonight he's here to tell us about his new book, Heard and Overheard, which is a beautiful book and has a designer by the name of Robert Weiser, who's put a lot of work into the jacket. Robert Weiser is here this evening. Can he stand up? A very, very nice job. The publisher has put a lot of work into this book. It all pays off. So here is Jim Symington to talk about his book.
Well, thank you so much, my lady, for such a kind introduction. I'm kind of overwhelmed by the gang here. I haven't seen this many people, I don't know, since I was running for office years ago. Well, Let's see here. Oh. No, frankly, I am overwhelmed by this gang. I see so many friends out there, I couldn't even begin to count them all. I'm so glad they came. I hope they're not disappointed. So, let's see, this is something here. Oh, yes. Yes, what is this? It's a good question. And another memoir by another elder statesman. Well, elder, for sure. But rather an anthology of thoughts, remarks, credos, assertions, conversations, pronouncements, asides, and hopefully bon mots. The detritus, if you will, of 80 years and counting. Over any lifetime, certain comments, expressions, fragments of conversation catch the ear and stick, ranging in my case from doggerel to prayer. My supply has fashioned the boundaries of my limited understanding of the world. So this book, as I hope you will perceive after you have bought copies for yourself, your family, friends, neighbors, people on the street, is an anthology of sorts, divided, as Caesar said of Gaul, in tres partes, that's three parts for you, which cover the major realms of my lucky life. Politics in the broadest sense, international mischief, and scenes beyond the view of the madding crowd. So saying, I start out. Keeps me from getting a big head. These are chapters, by the way. My Republican maternal grandfather, James Wadsworth of Geneseo, New York, was Speaker of the New York State Assembly at the age of 27 and subsequently served 2 terms in the U.S. Senate and 9 in the House. A veteran of the Spanish-American War, where he saw how poorly trained were volunteers like himself, he became a stickler for military preparedness, as evidenced in the Selective Service Act of October 1940, which he sponsored and which bore his name. But the most President Roosevelt could get out of Congress was a 1-year draft. So, as events of 1941 began to shape the world, in August of that year, the President called on Congress to extend the draft, which was about to expire. No admirer of Roosevelt, my Republican grandfather, Wadsworth, nevertheless, supported his request and championed his bill. The debate was hot and heavy, as members of both sides of the aisle questioned the wisdom of intervening in yet another European squabble that did not warrant our involvement. When Wadsworth took the floor in August 2, 1941, the House was packed. There was a reserve of respect for his views because he had chaired the Senate Military Affairs Committee in World War I. And as an elder statesman, enjoyed the confidence of his colleagues in both parties. As you see, he went from the Senate to the House later on. Giving due recognition to arguments on the other side, including Congress's commitment to a 1-year service, he reminded them that, quote, Hitler, Mussolini, Toyo, they're controlling the ball, calling the plays, and refereeing their own game. He pointed out that an army is a set of teams. For example, 3 men who can take a machine gun to the top of a hill and hold that position. To break up those teams, he said, would render us vulnerable for a dangerous period. His bill to extend the draft after his fervent speech for another year passed by one vote. My older brother Tim and I, as teenagers, were working that summer on Grandpa's farm. He kept a bushel basket on his front porch with nothing in it but hate mail, denouncing him as a warmonger, no consideration for young American lives. Every morning he would reach down into the basket, pull out a few, read them thoroughly, and put them back. My brother Tim, who had the nerve, finally said, "Gramp, why do you do that to yourself?" "Well," he said, "I tell you, boys, it keeps me from getting a big head." According to my grandmother, on December 8, 1941, the day after Pearl Harbor, Army Chief of Staff General George Marshall called Grandpa to say, "Wadsworth, you have saved 2 million American lives and shortened the war we are about to enter by 2 years. Thought you'd like to know." At the Democratic Convention in 1960, its chairman, House Speaker Sam Rayburn, who had participated in the 1940 House debate that I've just discussed, took my brother and me aside to say in his long career he had heard many speeches that changed members' votes, but only one that changed the result of the vote. That was your granddaddy's speech on the Draft Extension Act. Its passage ensured that 3 months later, i.e. December 7, 1941, we had at least 600,000 men-at-arms ready to start the job. "We don't serve your kind." This was the icy reminder of a prim little waitress in Tucumcari, New Mexico. In June 1943, Brother Tim and I were heading for our summer jobs on a ranch in Arizona when the train broke down and we were told to find lunch in town. One passenger was a young black soldier, trim in his uniform with campaign ribbons. He had stepped off the train and with the other passengers walked across the tracks to the lunch counter. Some 20 of us were in line for service, including this decorated young veteran. When he reached the head of the line, the waitress, without looking up, said, "We don't serve your kind." At 15, I had no idea what she meant by that. My brother explained. As a soldier turned to leave, I said, "Well, what do you want? I'll get it for you." At this, the entire crowd glared at me. I had apparently said something unpardonable. The soldier, smiling, said, "Now don't you go getting in trouble with these good folks." He then went around back, as he'd been told, to the kitchen entrance. No longer hungry, we left, wondering what he thought about the America he was defending. When we saw we were down to you, graduating from Deerfield Academy, Mass. In June 1945, I went directly on to Yale for its so-called accelerated summer session, part of the vaunted V-12 program organized to compress college curricula from 4 to 2 years, rendering graduates free to enlist in the armed services. Toward the end of June, a Marine Corps recruiter gave an inspiring speech on the campus, which determined me at 17 to get my father's position, had to do that, to enlist at the close of the freshman term in early August. Arriving August 9 at the Marine Corps recruiting station in Bridgeport, Connecticut, I took the oath administered by a muscular master sergeant. I also took the occasion to ask him about the mysterious bomb reported to have been dropped on Hiroshima just 4 days earlier. Looking disdainfully at my 128-pound frame, he explained, "Son, when we saw we were down to you, we went with everything we had." It's true. That's quite an introduction. Can we do it? There are some of us left who can well recall an America where virtually all places of public accommodation were racially segregated. This was certainly the case in Missouri when in 1954 I entered the practice of law as assistant city councilor in St. Louis. In 1955, St. Louis's famous mayor, Ray Tucker, asked my boss, Sam Liberman, for an opinion as to whether the city had the power to enact a public accommodation ordinance requiring hotels and restaurants licensed by the city to provide equal service to all regardless of race. Among the arguments in opposition was that such an initiative was properly the province of state law and that cities were powerless to act on their own. But St. Louis and Kansas City were classified in Missouri law as home rule charter cities with direct responsibility for the exercise of police powers. What do you think? Asked Sam, my boss. Can we do it? The assignment to prepare a draft opinion required delving into municipal practices and their legal bases nationwide. The jurisdictional objection that such powers were reserved to the states was obviated by the myriad ordinances in southern cities that required segregation, albeit with the benign complicity of their state governments. The Missouri Constitution, on the other hand, made it clear in its preamble that the purpose of government was to ensure equal treatment to all under the law. The St. Louis I came home to with my LLB was neither prepared nor inclined to welcome the proposed change. In any case, what would in effect be a civil rights ordinance would most certainly be challenged at the state level. Acknowledging that such an ordinance would thus be tested in the Missouri Supreme Court, my opinion suggested it would survive that test, if narrowly. The prevailing consensus in St. Louis was reflected in the Board of Aldermen's defeat of the proposal. At this point, the Kansas City Human Rights Committee wrote asking for my research. I provided it. Praise be, the Kansas City City Council passed a similar ordinance, which went, as predicted, to the Missouri Supreme Court, which upheld it by a vote of 5-4. By then, I had left Missouri. But the answer to Sam's question so long in coming was, yes, we can. Correspondence between nonagenarians. In 1958, my mother's cousin, John Hay Whitney, offered me an opportunity I could not refuse, a position as his assistant at our embassy in London. Needless to say, I leapt at it. One afternoon, the receptionist called me to say, there's an old fellow out here wants to see the ambassador. The boss was on home leave, so I stepped into the waiting room. There, holding a crumpled felt hat, stood a stooped, white-bearded ancient. His once elegant tweed suit was now short of buttons, long on soup stains and cigarette burns. I am Baron Meyendorf, he said, and I've come here to inquire into the health of Senator Green. I read in a magazine he was not well. Senator Theodore Green of Rhode Island, at 90 years of age, was then the oldest member of Congress. I asked the Baron how they became acquainted. We were in school together in Austria, he replied, in the 1890s. You can reach me at the refugee home on Cromwell Street. Good day. I wrote the senator at once, telling him of the visit of a gentleman I could best describe as a Santa Claus fallen on hard times. Within a week, I received a letter from the senator informing me that Baron Alexander von Meyendorf was the most distinguished living Russian and, moreover, a friend of his youth. Folded in the letter was a $200 check that the senator warned me not to give the Baron, as he would immediately make it over to someone he considered less fortunate. Find out what he needs, the senator wrote, and get it for him. I began the mission by calling on Miss Agnew, the austere British lady who ran the refugee home. Commenting on the respect shown him by his fellow East European castaways, she recalled the earlier visit of a lady aristocrat of old Russia, who said they had danced together in the Tsar's palace at the turn of the century. Learning of the Baron's whereabouts, she had come to pay him a visit. Advised that this grand dame was waiting downstairs, he said, "Send her away, she's a pest." Addressing my mission, Miss Agnew continued, "He needs pajamas, bathrobe, yes, a shirt, ascot tie, perhaps. Oh, yes, a new chair." Having met all those requirements at Harrod's, I phoned to say I would be calling on the Baron at tea time. Meeting me at the door, he led me into the sitting room where an assortment of his contemporaries were playing cards. "Out," he said, in a voice that was accustomed to command. They departed like wraiths into the hallway, leaving the two of us sitting by the window in the late afternoon sunlight. "Now," he said, sitting back, "why have you come?" Hesitant to broach the subject, I began by reporting that I had notified Senator Green of his visit to the embassy and the reason for it. "Fine, fine," said the Baron. "And the Senator was delighted to hear of you." "Yes, yes, that's fine." "And he wanted to be remembered to you." "Oh, well, yes, that's nice," says the man. "In that connection," he said, I said, "he wished me to express his pleasure in hearing from you by providing some things you might need." The Baron, getting the point and noting my discomfort, said, "Don't be embarrassed, young man. I've been in your position many times." This was my cue to present him with the shirt and the tie. "Ridiculous," he muttered, donning the latter with a deft twirl. "That's not all," I said. "Oh, dear. Would you like to see my room?" "Certainly." We climbed the rickety stairs to a third-floor bedroom, no more than 10 feet square. It contained an unmade bed, a chest, an armchair that sank to the floor. The new one had not yet arrived. He then told me about his life. His mother, he said, was a lover of the composer Franz Liszt. His family had owned enormous estates in pre-revolutionary Russia. A historian by profession, he was a technical advisor for Bernard Pear's exhaustive History of Russia, a great book, by the way. He then told me his wife had died a few years earlier and was buried in the coastal town of Torquay. "If the senator wishes to help me further," he said, "I should like to be buried next to my wife." He also said he would write to thank Senator Green. But, he reflected, correspondence between nonagenarians is a difficult thing. When I asked him how he spent his time, he said he walked every day to the library of the British Museum, a mile up the road. "Well, surely you could take a bus," I suggested. "No, indeed," he replied. "I'm afraid I'd pop off and be a bother to the driver." After I returned to the States to join my father's presidential campaign, I received a letter from Miss Agnew relating that the Baron had passed on and was buried as he wished. What a guy. Lust for life. I was standing beside Ambassador Whitney, the embassy, London, when he bade farewell to hundreds of American citizens who had attended the 4th of July reception at the embassy residence, Winfield House. The mansion was festooned with works of art from his own private collection, among them Renoir's Dancer, Picasso's Boy with a Pipe, Thomas Aiken's The Oarsman, and centered in the dining room, glaring at the viewer, the haunting Van Gogh self-portrait that had been on the cover of a best-selling biography, Lust for Life, which in turn became a great hit movie. This evoked a cry of delight from one of the guests. "Look," he enthused, "it's Kirk Douglas." As the star-struck visitors departed, another, taking his host's hand in both of his, gushed, "Mr. Ambassador, I didn't know you paint." will always be in America. Oh, those people! In February 1961, as deputy director of the newly constituted White House Office of Food for Peace under George McGovern, I was dispatched to survey the food needs of our neighbors to the south. At my first stop, Caracas, Venezuela, I was described in the newspaper as El joven con poco barbie, beardless youth. It was not long before I became aware of the race and class distinctions that President Kennedy hoped to mitigate through his newly announced Alliance for Progress, Alianza para Progreso. A vivid example was provided by a visit to the home of a Peruvian grandee in Lima. We were sitting on his veranda, which overlooked the city as far as the horizon, when he surprised me with the question, "Why are you here?" I explained that my mission was to survey the nutritional needs of the continent. "But why here?" asked my host. "There is no hunger here." Puzzled, I pointed to a tiny blue painted church atop a distant hill which I had visited earlier that day. It was the centerpiece of a barrio called Leticia, where youngsters, suffering from protein deficiency and malnutrition, were carrying buckets of fetid water collected from puddles up to their cardboard huts. "Oh, those people," he exclaimed. "They've lived like that for centuries." The disconnect between my host's perception and the reality I just witnessed was too startling to address politely. It was no wonder the Cuban Revolution resonated throughout the continent, a condition JFK hoped to head off with his Alianza para Progreso. Unfit to preach. One of my early missions as administrative assistant to Attorney General Robert Kennedy was to pay a courtesy call on the director of the FBI, J. Edgar Hoover. Not at Bob's request, to be sure, the two were never close. But at the insistence of my father, who considered it a prudent initiative. This was before the Bureau got its own headquarters on Pennsylvania Avenue, the J. Edgar Hoover building in the brutish modernist style, which took 12 years to build and cost over twice its initial budget. I first checked with Hoover's designated envoy to Bob's office, the natty, soft-spoken, and discreet Courtney Evans, who thoughtfully briefed me on protocol in the FBI precincts within the Justice Department. Dark suits were the rule, somber ties, no sport coats or flashy neckwear. According to Evans, should an agent appear out of uniform, Hoover would attribute the lapse to a temporary absence of understanding, deriving perhaps from a form of mental illness. Fortified with this useful information, I secured an appointment, and in my Sunday best called on the director. Receiving me warmly, he proceeded to relate how he had captured a certain Lepke bookholder who had fallen afoul of the law as kingpin of the organization known as Murder Incorporated. This charming introductory reminiscence of an event 34 years earlier was followed by a sudden and totally unexpected tirade against the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr., an immoral man in Mr. Hoover's lights, unfit to preach to others, a distinct danger to the Republic. How had Hoover arrived at this novel thesis? Apparently, under his orders, a bugging of Reverend King's hotel room had produced information. Get that, they were bugging his hotel room. Had produced information about a liaison with a woman other than his wife. In Mr. Hoover's view, this impropriety deprived the Reverend of credibility in matters moral and most certainly disqualified him as a national leader worthy of respect. Upon these debatable conclusions, prudence dictates a seemly silence. "Judge not that ye be not judged," as one might quote the only sinless man who's walked the earth or is likely to. Nevertheless, 4 decades after Dr. King was murdered while on a mission to support workers striking for fair wages, he was honored with the dedication of a monument to his memory on the National Mall. 4 decades after Mr. Hoover died, at home, a lifelong bachelor, the headquarters building that bore his name was declared obsolete, unfit for rehabilitation or renovation, and subject for demolition. We love our Negroes. This hopeful observation was made by a University of Mississippi student at a gathering held to hear me out as Attorney General Kennedy's representative during the integration crisis of 1962. The crisis arose when Governor Ross Barnett refused to admit James Meredith, a Negro, to Ole Miss, and the president sent federal marshals to guarantee his rights. It was a challenging time for the school authorities, the students, the teachers, the entire town, needless to say, Meredith himself, the agent of change, who moved through the scene with stoic demeanor. A few days after the crisis peaked and the riots ended, I addressed a local Lions Club lunch attended by students, who then invited me to their off-campus house. There, I was expected to consume a roasted squirrel, including the brain. Must I asked. Yep, it's the first thing I gotta eat. No exceptions? No, sir. There being no escape, I plunged the glutinous little white ball well past my taste buds, as far down my throat as I could. He did it, they yelled. The Yankee did it, damn. Now, wait a minute, I said. I'm from Missouri, a border state. At the insistence of my hosts, who made it clear that we don't water our drinks, I quaffed a tumbler of uniced bourbon before we got to discussing the reasons for the federal presence in their normally untroubled community. Among the numbing comments made during the ensuing discussion, the most memorable was that of an earnest undergraduate. "Something y'all ought to know," he said. "We love our Negroes." This reassuring claim was modified by the answer given to my next question as to why they would object to schooling with folks they loved. "You don't understand," said the spokesman. "We don't love them that way. We love them different." I said perhaps we should take love out of the equation and simply accept the notion of an equal opportunity to learn. Having providentially brought my guitar along, I sang a few lullabies before staggering back to my cot in the administration building. Returning to Washington, I was summoned to the Senate office of Mississippi's John Stennis. Expecting a dressing down, I was relieved by his explanation for the summons. "I just want to thank you," he said, "for the way you talk to my people." When I mentioned this to Bobby, he said, "What'd you say to the people?" I can't explain. So invited to attend the 30th anniversary of the landmark event at Ole Miss in 1992, I exchanged memories with Meredith, who had by then gone to work for North Carolina Senator Jesse Helms. Black students served on the university student council. The student body had elected a black homecoming queen. Change was in the air and on the ground. Okay. Got time for another? All right. My introduction to the life and times of a protocol officer was abrupt. In 1966, I had been, by President Johnson's appointment and at his pleasure, executive director of the President's Committee on Juvenile Delinquency. He must have thought I knew something about that. While attending a gathering of juvenile court judges in New York, I was summoned to the phone. "Jimmy," drawled LBJ, "Lloyd Hand has quit. Will you do it?" "Quit what, Mr. President?" "Chief of Protocol, will you do it?" One's hesitancy to answer the unknown is overcome by such a challenge from such a source. "Yes, sir," I said, counting the seconds to get to a dictionary. A day later, with right hand raised, I was sworn in by Secretary Rusk, who observed, "You have now graduated from the world of juvenile delinquency to the world of adult delinquency. Welcome aboard." The word protocol, I discovered, I'm sure you all know this, derives from the Greek words proto, first, and kolov, glue. Apparently a guarantee of the integrity of some early written agreements was the unbroken seal of glue that held the pages together from first to last. Within a month, I was able to refine the definition, to wit, if in a sticky situation you become unglued, you're not cut out for this work. And there were lots of those. Symington, you'll have to do better. To the best of my recollection, were the sounds emitted in 1967 from the wide open mouth of Chiselebwa Jonathan, Prime Minister of Lesotho, a small African nation, and President Johnson's honored guest. Rotund to an advanced degree, he overflowed the chair I proffered him at the President's direction and was making a gallant attempt to respond to the world leader's innocent inquiry, "Are you enjoying your stay in America?" Overwhelmed by the magnitude of that challenge, our stage-struck visitor could not articulate a reply. The President then pulled his own chair up closer and, in the manner of a concerned orthodontist, peered down the mouth of the stricken chief, as if his looming proximity could evoke a response. The chief's eyes rolled beseechingly at me. My cue to inform the President the visit was going very well, thank you, sir. The President sighed, leaned back, stood up, and with a disapproving glance at me, made for the exit to the Rose Garden. I was left to escort my trembling charge to the door and limousine. Returning to view the damage, I was met by the President's longtime aide, Marvin Watson, who chided me. "Symington, you'll have to do better with your people." My poor people. Your plane, sir. In the spring of 1966, President Johnson scheduled a meeting of Asian leaders at what would come to be known as the Manila Conference on the Vietnam War. On arrival at Andrews Air Force Base, he was taken in hand by the base commander. Preoccupied as he was with the multiple problems of office, LBJ strode along the long line of parked military aircraft. As he turned and placed a foot on the ramp of the nearest C-130, his escort courteously checked his progress, gesturing toward a giant plane down the line, the majestic Air Force One. "Your plane, sir, is over there." "Son," replied the President, "they're all my planes." Are we still alive? A good question. In October 1966, President Johnson presided over the seven-nation Manila Summit Conference. Its purpose was to brief the heads of state of South Korea, Australia, Malaysia, New Zealand, Singapore, and the Philippines on the conduct of the Vietnam War and to secure their support for its continuance. The briefing was presented by General William Westmoreland, trim and bemedaled commander of the U.S. forces. A large backdrop map of Southeast Asia enabled him to highlight the contested areas. With an electronic pointer, he directed our attention from one sector to another, pronouncing each in turn secure and concluding victory was at hand. The President asked whether there were any questions. There were none. The President, unaccountably to my mind, then said, "General, is there anything you need?" Westmoreland responded, "Yes, sir, 100,000 more men." Turning to his array of expressionless guests, the President again asked, "Any questions?" Again, there were none. The President then thanked the General, adjourned the meeting, shook hands with his colleagues, and flanked by his security detail, headed for the door. Having attended the meeting as his chief of protocol, I took the opportunity to approach the dais where the General was gathering his papers, preparing to exit. I found my voice and introduced myself. "Ah, yes," he said, "know your father." "Yes, sir. And I have a question." "What's that?" "Well, sir, if we're doing so well in the war, why would we need any more troops, never mind such a large number?" The General regarded me with a kind of inward gaze and replied, "Son, that's a good question." He then turned on his heel and walked away. a response that literally buckled my knees. Had the question been put by one of the attending heads of state, I wonder to this day what the necessarily more diplomatic answer might have been. Congressman, or some other fool thing, President Johnson and I had just bade farewell to Israeli Prime Minister Levi Eshkol and his party at the conclusion of his December 1967 visit to the LBJ ranch. I took that occasion to mention to the president my intention to run for Congress from St. Louis the following year. The president, carrying the woes of the Vietnam War on his back and conscience, along with protesters' cries of, "Hey, hey, LBJ, how many kids did you kill today?" settled back in his chair. With a kindly smile, he said, "Well, I knew you're going to be a teacher, a preacher, congressman, or some other fool thing. I'll campaign for you or against you, whichever you think will help you the most." He was feeling the pain. Why Aborigines don't sweat. The causes of this phenomenon were the subject of a $100,000 study, which the National Science Foundation proposed in its 1974 budget request. It evoked derision on the part of Congressman Robert Bauman of Maryland, Republican. Waving the overall budget in the air, he wondered aloud whether the American people really wanted or needed to know, never mind pay for, the answer to such absurd inquiries. As manager of the budget bill on the floor of the House, I pled temporary ignorance as to the rationale for this particular item, but I promised to enlighten my colleague and indeed Congress on the matter. 2 days later, I was able to inform the House the request did not originate from the Department of Health, Education, and Welfare, nor the State Department, nor the Agency for International Development, but from the Defense Department. Apparently, our troops in Vietnam's sultry climate were wont to suffer from dehydration and its debilitating effects. And since it was known that Australian Aborigines could go without water for a week or more, the question arose as to whether some enzyme or other responsible for this phenomenon could in some way be ingested by or injected into our soldiers. A long shot for sure, but one that deserved a look, especially one would think by such hawks as my good friend from Maryland. It was not unpleasurable to bring this to his attention at a subsequent session. Although, to my knowledge, the answer never surfaced, the amount spent to attain it seemed a reasonable component of a $1 trillion investment in a doomed enterprise. I also took the occasion to suggest to the National Science Foundation they might adopt titles for future grant requests, which were less likely to provoke ridicule among the Philistines. Another one? Okay. "He said he'd blow you away." My 1976 campaign for the Senate took me to the pleasant community of Webster Groves in St. Louis County, home base of my retired predecessor in Congress, Tom Curtis. Tom had usually campaigned in an open convertible, wearing a white suit. My advisor suggested I do the same. It was rather fun waving to startled passersby. But I wondered why a puffing plainclothes detective found it necessary to run alongside the car, scowling in all directions. When I leaned over to ask, he said, between puffs, that they had received a death threat. I told him if that was the case, I should like to trade places with him. At least I'd be a moving target. Arriving at the bandstand for the speeches, I brought the matter up with the mayor. He explained that while threatening messages occasionally marked local celebrations, they were normally dismissed as crank calls. However, the one related to my scheduled appearance had the ring of authenticity. Apparently, a convincingly God-fearing citizen, aggrieved by my refusal to condemn the Supreme Court decision in Roe v. Wade, had called the state in no uncertain terms that he would blow that baby killer away. The message and manner of its delivery were deemed sufficient to warrant the precautionary protection of the jogging detective. I remember thinking, if I must be taken out at this point in my career, why couldn't it be by a godless communist rather than a good Christian? Tell them you're for an amendment. This was my father's advice in my 1976 campaign to succeed him in the Senate. Retiring in 1977, he had only a slight brush with the abortion issue. Already in his fourth and final six-year term, he was visited by a deputation of nuns who urged him to denounce the decision. While he declined to do so, he was certainly put on notice of the importance of this issue to adherents of the Catholic faith, including many of his best friends. Recognizing the looming political implications of the issue, he advised me as follows. Tell them you're for an amendment. Swell, Dad, what does it say? Never mind what it says, you're thinking about it. You mean I should tell them I'm considering some sort of restrictive amendment to the Constitution of the United States, which I cannot or will not yet define? Yes, that's exactly what I'm saying. His political instincts were sure. According to the opinion polls, my position cost me 30% of the votes off the top, which in turn assured me of placing third in the Democratic primary. This explains my mother's words when asked what she thought about politics. Not for the queasy, she said. On Tuesday, August 6, 1976, the Missouri electorate put an end to my quest to succeed my dad in the U.S. Senate. After the dust had cleared, campaign debts were paid, supporters thanked. One morning at breakfast, Dad mused, "Well, Jim, you've got a great future behind you." One more. Think of the Trinity. Retiring from Congress in 1977, I joined former Senator George Smathers of Florida and his Miami-based partner, Sidney Herlong, to form the law firm, as you can imagine, of Smathers, Symington, and Herlong. At the behest of an anti-apartheid intermediary, George and I agreed to represent South Africa while it shed its race-based laws in favor of majority rule. A trip to counsel the government on needed constitutional change featured one unforgettable cloudless Sunday, April 1980. Cape Town's mighty Episcopal Cathedral, St. George's, was filled, every seat taken. When the young minister stood to address a congregation whose racial composition mirrored that of the nation itself, pausing a moment to scan our faces, he began his sermon. My text today is a simple one. It derives from the concept of the Trinity. Three in one, that is, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, separate identities but merged in one Godhead. He then asked if this wasn't in fact a lesson to be learned. We have grown too accustomed, he said, to seeing ourselves through the lens of our ethnicity rather than that of our humanity. A trinity, if you will, of black, Indian, white, or some combination thereof, in effect, one people. As he spoke, the entire congregation began to hold hands. Many wept. As we emerged, smiling into the bright Sunday air, the very day seemed to radiate hope. Hard decisions lay ahead. Recriminations, angry exchanges, retributions. But no one present at that service could have come away without confidence in the future. Thank you all. Oh, yes, by all means, yeah. I'm told that...
Okay, we have time for two or three questions.
This is the question and evasion period. Tea towel.
Congressman Symington, I'm calling you Congressman Symington, your many titles, because I have a legislative question about the Congress of the United States, House and Senate. If one would, I read your book, I bought it a week ago, in the wonderful talking about Tip O'Neill with Ronald Reagan and other legislators, your great father, Senator Stuart Symington, Theodore Francis Greene, wonderful statesman. If you read Politico and the Washington Post and those other wonderful things we read every morning, You'd think that Washington, the legislative branch of the United States of America, is full of narcissistic loudmouths who would rather fight than to govern this great nation of ours. Would you comment on the legislature in your time and what you see reading those wonderful papers in the morning?
Well, the latter part of your kind question about my friends there, I had lots of them on both sides of the aisle. In those days, we were allotted one trip home a month. This is just an angle. That meant that we were together three other weekends, and we got to know each other, and we had some respect for each other. That was filtered into the way we approached issues, that we could debate certain things, but it never with a personal touch or anger. Now, of course, you go home every weekend, and so you're splitting up. You don't know your colleagues the way I think we did, because we could be on opposite sides of an issue and still break bread together in one of the little sandwich shops on the floor of the house. I don't know quite what to do about all that. I think there ought to be an examination of a literary kind of how Congress works and how it should work, if possible. Because nowadays, I'm just not sure that there's a lot of cross-aisle fraternization. We had it all the time. I even sat on the other side a lot of the time, just to shoot the breeze with these guys. Also, both of the parties have their own little sort of sandwich shop at the end of the floor. I spent as much time in theirs as I did in my own, where you get to wrap it with your buddies on the opposite side. So I don't know, perhaps someone, you know, some smart person will write a kind of description of what's going on and maybe make some recommendations. All I know is that, although I had arguments and differences with guys, I don't think I had an enemy in the darn place. And today I think they avoid each other if they don't want to come together in any fashion. So I hope that helps answer the question, at least from my perspective. I would like to see the members get to know each other a little better. I would like to see situations where they can mix in between parties, either socially or in work, and realize that the devil isn't in the other people, it's in the problem. And let's see what we can do together to solve it. So keep your eye on it. You know, that's your Congress. Everybody in this room, your Congress. Find out what your people are doing to get along with the other side. Yep. Okay, we got a question. Oh, yes. Excuse me.
I'm a native of Greenfield in Dade County, down in the Ozarks, and grew up hearing my grandfather talking about your father, and so it's a pleasure to be here. Yeah. I wonder, as one Missourian to another, what your father, what your family, just your reminiscences about President Truman. Oh. And you also said something that sparks a memory. You mentioned being in Manila in 1966 with President Johnson. Yes. I wonder if that was the trip where he visited Canberra in Australia. It was sometime around then. I just wonder if you were on that trip and if you have any particular recollections of that.
Well, I do. Going to that question first. Of course, the Aussies love to see any American president, but especially Johnson, because as you know, in the Second War, the Japanese were moving pretty close, and the Aussies were very grateful for our victory, and Americans were well received throughout Australia and New Zealand. What was the rest of the question? President Truman was, as you can all understand, having read anything about him, was a remarkable guy. He was vice president almost by accident, and then suddenly became president, and people weren't sure that he was up to it. It didn't take him long to show that he absolutely was on domestic issues, on the threat from abroad. He was sound and solid, and certainly a great friend of my father's who adored him. When Dad ran for the Senate the first time, The president was a big help to him. What else can I say? It was a grand time. Truman. I went to see him once myself, and he was couldn't have been kinder. He was then, of course, retired and had a little house in Independence. And I remember when you go to see him, he doesn't have a big staff or anything. The Secret Service tells you to wait outside, and then they'll announce him, you to him inside, and then they'll wave in, you walk in. There were no guards at the door or anything like that. You just walk through the door of this little house in Independence, and you sit down with the man, and he reminisces in a kindly fashion, as you might expect of such a grand fellow. Any other questions?
Okay, I think that's it.
Is that it? So okay. All right. Thank you very much. Thank you. Wonderful. Thank you, man.